Oh, what's going on, guys? We're here. We're live. We're back podcasting again. The podcasting spree is continuing, guys. If you've been joining me the past couple days and you've been tuning into the Jason Moe or Kate Hall or Fader Holes podcast last night, thank you very much and welcome back. We're here. We're live. Today's guest is a young gentleman who Dan, are you considered a cash game player?
You know, I don't even know anymore. I used to play a lot of cash, and then I won some money playing a tournament and decided this is so easy. I should do this all the time. Mm. And then I did that for years and years and years with occasional successes and just never really getting over the hump. And now is like the time in the story where we're just like kind of coming back to reality and realizing, oh, maybe I would have a lot more money if I didn't take this path.
Well then, I think that's going to tell you, I might tell you a little bit about the podcast then, guys. So, half tournament player, half cash game player, somebody who is well known amongst the poker community and someone that I'm excited to have on the podcast. We talked a little bit with Kate yesterday about the podcast that she's been doing with Dan called Fighting Chance that they've done during the summer. That has been very enjoyable to listen to if any of you guys have checked it out. And I know some people had a lot of love for it yesterday during the pod. But his name is Dan O'Brien. What's up, Dan? Welcome to the pod, man. Do you have any nicknames? Is there like an acronym, an online name you use, or is it just Dan O'Brien?
No, I used to be Hold'em Dan when I made my party poker account like 10 years ago. That seemed, I don't know why that was my choice. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, oh, I was Hundo Fight on Stars. I guess I still am, which is just a dumb story. But yeah, mostly just my name, even though the decathlete has kind of taken over, you know, anytime you hear Dan O'Brien, like no one thinks of a poker player, which is fine.
There's an athlete with that name?
Yeah, there's a famous decathlete named Dan O'Brien who was in the Olympics like, I don't know, 15 years ago maybe? Maybe more like 20. It was Dan and Dave. They had like a whole – like Kellogg's or Nike or something sponsorship. There was a whole thing gearing up for the Olympics. And I think they both failed pretty hard. But yeah, like that's what, like danobrien.com, Dan O'Brien on Twitter. It's all this dude. That's why I just have to be Dan O'Brien Poker. He beat me.
I didn't even know that.
He's a lot more accomplished. He deserves it.
I was Googling it right now to take a look at it. Oh, wow. Did you retweet the link, Dan?
Nope, I'm really bad at this game.
Retweet it for the fans, man. Do you have a lot of fans, Dan, it seems like. Because I know about you. I think I found out about you, or I first saw you through a series you did on YouTube with D Moon Girl. You did like a one-on-one thing, I believe. It was like this cool show where you guys did these competitions, and I was like, this is fucking cool. And
it was called Me versus You.
Yeah, it was for Ultimate Poker, I believe.
Yep.
Yes, for Ultimate Poker, that was the first time I saw, like, actually, I think I saw both of you guys there. But I don't know much about your background in poker or your history in poker. Why don't you tell people a little bit about sort of how you came to be in this current position right now, sitting in this chair at the moment from poker?
I was just kind of a small-time grinder for a long time. And I just crushed online, starting out at 25, 50 cent up to 1-2. And just played, you know, heaps of tables, made plenty of money, and for whatever reason, just like never took the next step, never really got into the forums, never really became a better player. I was just good enough to beat these games. So I did that for a while, took some shots in the series, and then in 2008, I moved to Vegas in the spring and played a couple more events. I ended up coming in third place in a 2K for $200,000. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, I should play a bunch more tournaments, so I did. And I lost $50,000 or so in the next week. And then probably like another 20 in the next like few months. And then I met Jason Mercier, who decided to back me along with a couple other guys. And from there, I just started traveling the world playing cards and playing all the biggest tournaments. And I did like, you know, I did fine. I just came in second and third and fourth a fair amount. Or, you know, just like eighth. And when you do that and you just never really thing, the money goes quickly because obviously tournaments are expensive. And when you don't hit that big score, it's like you just never really kind of get the foundation to allow yourself to keep going, keep playing. So I just kind of hovered in this area for a while where I was doing fine, supporting myself, making money, but you know, between the expenses and then also, of course, having to split it with Jason, you just don't really end up with a whole lot to show for it. So that happened for years and years, and then culminated in me coming in seventh in the LAPC, I think 2 years ago, in a, you know, in brutal fashion to kind of like end my backing or backed career. And then from there, I've just been on my own, playing more cash and playing like a little bit smaller, not really traveling to Europe as much, but still taking shots in tournaments whenever I can and kind of just breaking even for now.
So you've been around poker for a long time.
Yeah, and then I think with Black Friday happening, that's when I guess people started to care a little bit more about me, because before that, being a white male from Vegas was just an absolutely worthless asset to any company. But then when Nevada was the only place in the States where you could play, you know, Ultimate Poker wanted to sign me, so I went with that. And then we made that show with T-Moon, which was a lot of fun to do. And yeah, from there, I've just been, you know, I've had like a couple sponsorship deals, which just puts my face out there. But, you know, that's pretty much the story for now.
So it sounds like the turning point of your career was when you decided to start playing more tournaments.
Yeah, I don't regret it because I've had a great, you know, what, 8 years, six, seven, 8 years. And I've had a lot of fun. I've gotten to travel the world and play. But, you know, also I've learned a lot from Jason and Alan Barry and some of the other guys that I traveled with, and they definitely made me a much better player than I was before. But I really can't, you know, it would be hard to have done worse playing cash in that time. I mean, cash games, I mean, I'm sure that's what you do mostly, right? You just play PLO cash?
I've only played cash for 8 or 9 years now. The second World Series of Poker event I ever played was this summer, and those were probably the less than 10 tournaments I've ever played lifetime.
Yeah, tournaments are a lot of fun, and they really are addictive more than any other form of poker. And I've never been addicted to poker. I've always kind of chosen to enjoy my life and take my free time. And if it's like, oh, there's these games to play, but these people are going out or, you know, just gathering, I've kind of chosen being social. And I have a lot of regret about that at sometimes, but for the most part, I'm okay with it. But tournaments are addicting in a weird way where it's like, I'm not like looking forward to playing them necessarily, but it's so hard to go, say during the summer and go play a cash game where I might be playing 5-10 or 10 and a quarter, where I might, you know, win or lose 5 or 10,000 at most. Like that's a really big swing for 5-10 and like, you know, a reasonable swing for 10 and a quarter. But in tournaments, like you could win, you know, $500,000 and just totally change your position, your financial position. And it's just, it's hard to say no to that.
Yeah, I guess it's about having the more long-term mindset when you're mainly just a cash game player and you realize that you change your position over an extended period of time rather than immediate period of time.
And that's like a really smart way of thinking about things. I am less rational, I think, in this sense. But I think it also comes down to a little bit of my regret for just not taking money more seriously for the last 10 years. And if I had, you know, $1 million+, it would be a lot easier. It's like, okay, let's just keep going, keep making money. You know, winning 100, 200,000 is not like a huge deal. I mean, it's nice, but it's, you know, it's not life-changing.
Right.
Or it's not going to change like what stakes you're playing, like all these things that you're doing. Whereas for me, it's like I don't have that much money. So winning, say, 300K would be huge. And therefore, it seems a lot more important for me to just kind of take those shots while they're available and then just play cash, you know, when they're not.
Pretty excited about this podcast, guys. We don't have a fucking robot cyborg who has like the Fedor thing going on. Like we had Fedor on the podcast last night. He's like, yeah, I'm ready to, you know, seems easy. You know, poker doesn't make me that happy. I'm just going to step away. And it's like, it's really easy to step away when you got fucking, when you got $10 million or something like that.
I know. Joe McKean the other day on Twitter is talking about how he, you know, he can't wait for ESPN, like, not to have the World Series. He can't wait for it to be not televised anymore. And all this stuff, it's like, bro, you just fucking won for $7.5 million. Like, shut the fuck up. Like, we, you know, some of us still need to make money here. And we want amateurs to come in and play. Like, I don't mind the spotlight. And to just, you know, I like Joe. Don't get me wrong. I just think it's annoying when people that are winning all the money are just kind of judging you for wanting poker to still be big and still have the opportunity to win all the money that you just won.
Well, technically, technically he didn't win $7.5 million.
Okay. Well, I have no idea. You know.
Oh, okay. Because one of my best friends, I think, had the biggest, maybe the bigger piece of him last year. So he kind of got third in the main event last year, and now he's at the final table again with another piece. So I'm very excited for him in that situation. You know, it's funny. I actually was talking to, I was at the gym last night playing ball. When I wrapped up, one of my friends mentioned to someone that I play poker professionally, and they say, oh, do you play on ESPN? Or you like play the tournaments? I'm like, well, technically no. Yeah. And they're like, oh yeah, the guy last year, he won like $8 million. I'm like, well, on the surface, sure. That's kind of how it works. It appears that the person wins $8 million. But then when you factor in, you know, they might have 20% of themselves and after taxes and all that stuff, they still win a pretty good amount of money, but they don't actually win anywhere near as close as what people think or you know, assume that they won from those type of things from the tournaments.
Right, right. I was talking to this girl that I met on some dating app, and she was going to come hang out, and she's like, you know, can I Google you just to make sure that you're not going to kill me? It's like, yeah, of course. And the first thing she types back is, you're rich? It's like, actually, no, not even close. I mean, I'm not struggling, but no. And one of like, all right, so probably the worst beat I've taken in my whole life kind of like comes into this topic. It was when I came in seventh in the LAPC. Seventh place was like 140 or 160K or something. And of course, we're on the bubble of the WPT televised final table, which has some other incentives to it. And first place is over $1 million. And I'm obviously excited in that moment. And I think I bought like 20% of myself at the time. Like, I was backed by Jay, but I was also buying pieces because I was doing okay. And if I busted in seventh place, I would have gotten like my own, like, you know, 20%, but I would have cleared the stake by $2,000. So I would have gotten $1,000, you know, aside from my own piece, and been on my own, no backing anymore. So I can't really afford to play these 10Ks. And so obviously that's, you know, factoring into how I'm playing. And I think I wound up playing this huge hand with Mike Rocco, where I think he played it overly optimistically. And I got in for favorite on the turn, getting all the money in for like a $300,000 US equity pot. And it's like, you know, I never, in a cash game, like, how often are you going to play a $300,000 pot? It's like, me, maybe never in my whole life. So these situations just kind of come up in tournaments, and you just have to win a couple of them every now and again in order to have any money. Right. And I have not won them, and I did not win this one. And so instead of, you know, having a huge equity slice of getting this $1 million top prize, I end up with $1,000. And it will mark on my score as like 140, but really I got like 20 something from it and was, you know, in tournament terms, broke. And it's just like very, very frustrating. But that is what happens in tournament poker all the fucking time. And that's why it looks like we have a lot more money than we do.
So I guess you haven't considered, I mean, I'm sure you have considered, but you just in the past just decided not to do the cash game thing, not to go back to cash games, whether it's live or whether it's potentially online.
It's honestly, it's more a factor of just like what I want to do in the moment. And I'm kind of lazy and I value my own time way too highly. So it's like, okay, I can go sit there and make 100 or $200 an hour, depending on the game. which sounds great, but at the end of the day, it's like, okay, like you're not going to win or lose that much. And I'm just going to have to like sit in this casino all day long with these people I really don't want to hang out with and really don't want to talk to. And I just like end up talking myself out of going to play. But I'm going to start to go to play more. I mean, I lost money in the series. I don't even know how much. But I'm going to go play some more in Vegas. And then I'll play in Florida. I'm going to go play the tournaments down there and also play cash on the side. So I'm going to start devoting a lot more of my time to cash because I just have to at this point.
So you mentioned you lost money in the series. How would you, what would you say your approach or your plan or your strategy was going into the series?
I put a lot of my like bankroll on the line, and that's not like entirely my net worth because I'm 32 now and I try to be a little bit smarter and have like an IRA and a little bit extra money. But for the most part, like I put, you know, probably half of my bankroll into tournaments, which isn't the most intelligent thing to do, but it's also, you know, whatever. Like if I lose it, okay, I'm going to be doing the same thing as if I didn't play at all, because it doesn't really affect my ability to play like 5, 10, and 10, 20 that much. So I went for it, and I was, you know, I made some not deep runs, but like okay runs into the money, like top 5%. The Colossus, both years I came in the top 1% of the tournament and made effectively no money for it. So that should be a good, you know, reason to stay away from tournaments, kids. But yeah, I had like some shots in the series and nothing really worked out. I was around even. And then the last like 2 weeks, I probably lost 30,000 or 40,000. So pretty frustrating end, but I think I'm a better tournament player than I've ever been. And just a better poker player in general than I've ever been. It's just that everyone else is getting better too. So it's not the easiest.
So you have been blogging, or you've been doing a podcast rather with Kate called Kate yesterday, and Fighting Chance is kind of it's documented your summer in a pretty fun style. It's got music, it's got nice production behind it. I've certainly enjoyed it. I listened to the first couple episodes at the gym, and I thought it was great. I thought it was something that, you know, my family could listen to and understand and get a feel for exactly, you know, what you guys are going through, what poker players go through. And I guess, what was kind of the reasoning for wanting to do something like that?
I listened to a podcast called Startup, which is the story of the narrator trying to start a podcast company and kind of going through it, raising money, pitching investors, and then finding a partner, like all the ins and outs that you really wouldn't think are all that entertaining or interesting. But when you break it down in a transparent and honest way, I found it really compelling. And I thought that there really hadn't been anything done like that in poker. And like we talked about, like most of the time we're seeing, you know, just like these numbers put up, and no one actually knows how much money you're making. No one really knows like what kind of position you're in and about all of these things that are going on. So I just wanted to make something that was kind of like the most honest look that we could create at poker, and also make it, like I said, or like you said, for your family. So it's not really geared towards professionals. I mean, hopefully they find it interesting, but it's more of something that, you know, if you're interested at all, like in the human condition, or just like, you know, the struggle of following your dreams and, you know, trying to make money at something that you enjoy doing, then you should be able to get that out of this podcast. Well, that's our hope anyway.
You guys can find it on iTunes if you want to check it out. If you haven't checked it out yet, I know we've just got a lot of good comments from on people on Twitter I've seen on chat yesterday. Have there been any feedback from other potential poker players about maybe going through the same sort of ups and downs and struggles that you guys talk about on there?
Yeah, we've gotten a lot of great feedback, which is really all that I wanted. I mean, it's not something that I'm going to make money off of. In fact, I'm probably going to take a reasonable hit just producing it, because I'm paying the people that are helping me to produce it like a fairly decent amount of money. But I just wanted to create something good, and hopefully people can find, some kind of like similarities in there, whether they're poker players or not. And, I'm proud of it. Hopefully we achieve something like we wanted to achieve, but they're just like there's just so much nonsense out there. And even with, like me versus you, it's like, I really enjoyed doing that. I think it was funny. And I think that it was like pretty good for the most part, but still a lot of it is, just like, it looks different than it is, like there's a kind of always a facade. Where with this, it was just us being as honest as we could, recording our thoughts at times that we really didn't want to, but just doing it anyway, and just giving people the best look that we could. And we've gotten a lot of, good feedback from people, from, guys I don't know that just play cards like in their random card room, all the way up to Negranu, who said he was listening and enjoyed it. So, we'll take it. Whatever. It'd be nice if we had like a bunch more people listening, because then we'd be able to actually make our money back off it, maybe make some more either throughout some other tournament series or maybe next WSOP. But, whatever happens, if people enjoy it, I'm okay with that.
Guys, we're live on YouTube. Most comments and questions are appreciated. Some, you're going to get a fucking timeout if you're annoying in the chat. That's why you may be getting timed out in the chat, Marco, if you're wondering why am I getting timed out in the chat. That's why. Okay?
There's a great tweet yesterday from Liv Bree that Berkey and I were just cracking up about, where
I saw that.
Yeah, Jay Merce, is talking about like, why does every girl want to get married in a garden? And Sean Deep replies something like, 99.9% of girls just want to hit the two outer in like relation to like some wedding planning thing. And Liv Bree just responds, and she's like, this doesn't really help your I'm not a misogynist stance, Sean. Do you understand why? It's just like, I could just see her as like a teacher talking down to a child. Like, do you understand why? And I just, I love Liv, and that's just, I don't know if she meant it like that, but that's how it came off, and I thought it was so funny.
So is he still sticking with that claim that he made on the podcast here that he's not?
Oh, Sean? I don't know. I don't really know Sean D very well. I like him, and I've never had any issue with him. But yeah, I mean, that's like clearly not the greatest thing to say. I mean, I personally wouldn't have gone after him for it, because I'm pretty loose when it comes to language, especially. I respect Liv for taking a stance.
So we're talking about the podcast, and I think you don't really see people being that honest about the actual experience and the ups and downs very often, because some people feel like it makes them look bad or makes them look some type of way, and everyone wants to look very strong and powerful and look like they're super rich and look like they're living the fucking high life and look like they're Mr. GTO at everything when it comes to anything. So I think that's a very refreshing look, and and I think people really appreciate and respect the honesty.
Yeah, I just want to work on my game and get better. And I think that learning, like the past few months, I've put a lot more work into my game. And the biggest thing that I've learned is that I have a lot to learn. And that's great. Like I feel like I'm a much better poker player than I was a year ago. And I'm way less confident than I was a year ago. And I think that's entirely natural. Typically the people that are like most confident and arrogant really don't know what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. It's the people that are truly like experts or like, are trying to become experts that are filled with doubt. And it's that reason that we end up like looking up to people who don't really know what they're talking about, because they sound so sure of themselves, but really they have no idea. And I don't think I've ever really thought that I was like the best. I mean, at one point I thought I was a much better tournament player than I now think that I am. But also at the time, no one was really any good. So we were all just kind of figuring shit out, or at least that's what the boat I was in. But I've never really thought that I was like great. I've just figured I was good enough to beat most of the people in these tournaments. And that was good enough for me, because I figured I'd probably get out of poker soon enough. And I didn't think that I really, it was really cost effective or time effective for me to put in a lot of work into getting better at tournaments. Now I'm, you know, kind of going back on that. But I think a lot of people kind of group me in with kind of like poker celebrities that are like just aren't any good at poker, but like, you know, claim to be the best. And number one, like I just don't have like anywhere near that kind of following to be like in that group of poker celebrities. But also I've never really claimed to be the best. Just like, all right, Ultimate Poker came and they said, hey, we want to pay you money to do some fun stuff. I said, okay, that sounds great. Like I enjoy entertaining. I enjoy all these things that you're asking me to do. So I'm for it. And for, you know, whatever reason, some people just get really bitter that you're in this position and just start to spew shit at you. And I've dealt with that a fair amount, but it's like, you know, whatever. I'm not up here claiming to be better than you. I'm just in this spot because they said, hey, we'll give you this money and you can do this. And that's kind of been like the same with any sponsorship that I've had. And I just feel, I don't know. I feel like for that reason, I don't deserve a lot of like the nonsense that I've gotten from time to time. But I guess no one really deserves it. People just like to spew shit because they're bitter, and tournament poker kind of embitters people. And that just happens.
We got my buddy John Bopress in the chat. He says, Dan is a really cool guy. Played with him in Colorado a couple years ago and the table loved him.
Thanks, man. That's, I mean, honestly, those are like the comments that I love to hear because I just want to go out having a good time. And also that makes me have a good time. I mean, I don't want to go to a table and just sit there and like read or put my headphones on. I want to go and enjoy talking to people. It just so happens that at the poker table, sometimes that happens really easily. And sometimes just like, I just can't talk to any of you guys. You know, I just can't do it today. So I try to bring the former self out much more than the latter, but you know, some days are good. Some days are rougher.
So you mentioned you want to get better at poker, and so you mentioned also that you mentioned a couple things, and what I talked about your approach this summer. So I know that you enjoy going out. You enjoy hanging out with, you know, friends, women. You enjoy potentially maybe getting yourself out of line in terms of some extracurricular activities. Now, those things don't really coincide with having your best focus, having your best results, playing your potential A game, being able to sit there for 10, 12 hours and play these tournaments.
I think that you're right on a very basic level, but that everyone is different. So yes, I definitely could have put some more effort in to, you know, playing some more tournaments this summer, playing some more cash when I busted tournaments, but I also have to realize what's best for me. And sometimes I just can't play cards for 2 weeks straight and be there day in and day out and just grinding all day long. And I just need to kind of have that social aspect, especially when it's just going on around me. Excuse me, when I have like EDC is going on or when just people are in town and they're going out to this place. It's like if I'm sitting there playing cards when I don't want to be there, I'm not going to play well. And I really can't change how much I want to be there. So, yeah, if it's like a big tournament, I'll gear myself up and say no to some of these other things. But if I've been playing for a week and there aren't that many great tournaments or the tournaments are like, you know, 1Ks or 1500s, like my edge in that tournament or my profit in that tournament like isn't, you know, super high, then, yeah, I'm just like going to go out and have a good time and then feel a lot better coming back to playing cards. Like there's been so many situations where I've decided to play a tournament and it's like getting towards the end of the day and there's like a pool party tomorrow morning that I'm like a bunch of my friends are going to and I want to go to. It's like, well, I don't want to end this day with like two starting stacks, you know? I need to either end it with like eight or I'm just going to, you know, dust off my chips and go.
See, that seems like a bad way to look at it from my perspective.
Okay, go ahead.
Because, and you know, I'm not a tournament player, so I wish I knew how to speak about this matter better, but that just seems like, I don't know, it seems like if you're not 100% focused on poker, on each decision you're making, on doing the best you can at poker, I suppose, then, like when you're thinking about, all right, I want to go out. So I'm going to go out. I mean, that's just always in the back of your mind. It's sort of affecting your decisions. And I mean, it doesn't seem like over a long period of time that can just be the best approach.
Right. Well, that's why I'm saying, like, so now instead of just like playing that tournament that I don't really want to make day two of with a double starting stack, I just don't play that tournament and I just take it off and then I just go do what I'm going to do. And then I'll come back when I want to play and actually play as best I'm able and focused. You disagree with this approach?
Well, I don't disagree with that approach. I think overall, it's just that for me personally, when I'm mixing poker with going out a lot and drinking a lot and having these worries, it's just really hard for my mind to always stay extremely sharp as I know it can be. Whereas even if I take a break or I take a couple of days off, you know, depending on what I do with those days off, whether it's study my game or just talk a lot of poker, I feel like the times that I've talked poker and focused and kind of been low key, that's when I have my best results at poker. But when I start mixing in these late hours or mixing in drinking or mixing in, you know, these other moments, it's like, you know, I've always been about that. To really have the best results you can at poker, you have to sacrifice things. You have to sacrifice some of these really, you know, like you want to have these extremely great moments in your life or these extremely fun moments with people in your life. But at the same time, it's almost like those could potentially be harmful for some people when it comes to actually focusing on poker and having the most success you can at poker.
Yeah, I don't disagree with you at all. I just think, and like really, I didn't go out that much this summer. I mean, it might have sounded like that on the podcast, but I took like 5 days off for EDC where I took off like the 2 days before because I knew that I wouldn't want to like make day two in some of these tournaments and I was just kind of over it. And then I took off 3 days for EDC, but two of those days were seniors events anyway. And one was like a 1K or 1500 something or other, like extended play or I don't know what they even had, but that's it. And then, you know, by Tuesday I was just back to playing and I went out like one or two more times, but I don't think it really had too much of a negative impact on my game. If anything, honestly, I think it had a positive impact on my focus because it's like I get out of my system, I have a good time, I go out, and I feel good about like the balance that's in my life.
Is it really a balance though? If you just take off 5 days and that's just a 5 day block sort of for this special moment, it doesn't seem like it's very much of a balance in that way.
Well, I mean, I played like the 8 days before and the 10 days after. So It seems like pretty reasonable to me. I don't know. I mean, if I were just playing for 3 weeks straight, I think that I might go ahead and lose my mind. And this is, you know, I love going to EDC. I think it's so much fun. And I just, every year I look forward to it. And I'm really stoked that the WSOP has taken to putting the seniors and super seniors event on the Friday and Sunday that weekend. It's like I miss one tournament and maybe like one leading up to it. So I'm, you know, whatever.
Luckily, they also put the 3K PLO 6 Max on that weekend too. Thank God for me. Every year they just happen to have the EDC on the PLO 6 Max event.
Yeah, I'm still horrendous at PLO. So unless I actually decide to get halfway decent at that, then that does not affect me.
Yeah, I luckily... See, okay, so I'll speak about this. So I was at day two of the 3K PLO, and It was before dinner break. I either bust out or I'm going to EDC. Like that, if I make dinner break on Sunday night, I'm not going to be able to go to EDC. So I may have made a decision that might not have been the most GTO in terms of a shove. I ended up busting that hand. I got 38th or 39th in the tournament, but I got to go to EDC. Now, so you say right there, right? Well, you know, were you really at your highest focus? Were you making the best potential possible play you could at that moment? The answer is no, because I just didn't because I wanted to, because in my mind, I knew if I bust out of here, it's fine. I get to go to EDC. Now, I'm sure like that probably plays in there for other people too, but just on maybe different levels. Maybe it's that night or maybe it's the next day. And I have to think that that can't be like, whereas if I wasn't going to go to EDC or if I didn't have that sort of idea in my mind, then I may have made a more plus EV decision. And
yeah, for sure. And that's, you know, that comes down to like why I just don't play the tournament on Saturday. or the one that was on Thursday, because I just know that I can't possibly make good decisions in those spots, and I'll just avoid it. So let me turn this interview around. What was going on in LA? I thought you were never coming to Vegas.
You know how it goes, Dan. You know how it goes, buddy.
Did you meet your future wife?
I don't think so. Is she watching? No, I don't think she shot the stalkers. if anybody knows about this, Dan, it could be you. You know, I think that sometimes you go to these places on trips and on journeys and you lose focus, right? Like I definitely lost focus. I think I made a very minus EV poker decision. See, this is, and this sort of ties in together. So my plan was to go to Vegas at the beginning of June, get into a good rhythm, get my diet, play cash games, hang out with people, do podcast. But I stayed in LA for an extra 2.5-3 weeks. My rhythm was fucked up. I end up not very focused in Vegas. I end up not really getting into a rhythm. I end up not really making much money at poker as my initial plan was, because I got distracted by a woman. You know, that's sort of how things go, right?
Yeah, it happens. I think I've been doing a lot better job of that lately, where there was a time where, you know, maybe like end of last year, I was hanging out with girls like 5 or 6 nights a week. And it got to the point where like I didn't even like want to hang out with the girl most of the time. It's just like I felt bad because I hadn't seen her in a while. And she's like, oh, like you never have time for me, this or that. And then you start to like do things to just like appease people, but you really can't be like any good for someone if you don't really even want to be there. So I kind of got into the spot where I was just doing these things because they were easy and because I was like talking myself into like doing it for the other person. And I just wasn't really accomplishing anything on my own. And I don't think I was like, you know, the best person to hang out with for them either. So that definitely tied into my decision to just leave Vegas. And I went to Tahoe for the first like 3.5 months of the year. Mm. And that just like really could not have gone any better. It was an amazing experience. I just love Tahoe. I snowboarded like almost every day. And I was just like much happier being on my own. And I think, I don't know if you can relate to this at all, but you start to, or at least I start to kind of on like the approval of women, or you know, the attention of women. And when that happens, you just like, you're not even really enjoying it all that much. You're just like, okay, I just need this now. And it just stopped me from kind of improving in any aspect of my life, whether it was poker or like, you know, fitness or like other projects I wanted, you know, to get to. And I was, you know, I got a lot out of that. And when I came back, you know, either I kind of like lost touch with some of those girls, or, you know, one of them got engaged somehow. You know, a couple of them, I was just like, you know, entirely over. And I was just like much happier being on my own and not, you know, needing to go hang out with a girl every night. Just like, all right, like I'm just going to do my own thing. Like read a book, get to sleep at a reasonable hour, like wake up and go to the gym instead of having to like, you know, make sure this girl gets breakfast, which like seems like a really like easy thing. And like, you know, I want to be a reasonable person, but like I don't eat in the morning. So for me, it's like I want to get up and start my day and like go to the gym fasted and, you know, start accomplishing things. It's like, okay, like, all right, like we need to go get you food and I'm not going to eat. So you're going to think that's awkward, but like, you know, I don't know what you want me to do. So there's just a lot of that. And I feel a lot better now being mostly independent.
I got to say, guys, this podcast, I'm enjoying this podcast because it's like a, this is like a real, this is like how most people think about these things. And most people have these sort of, you know, things going on. And what you mentioned before, what you mentioned right now, rather, is one, I got a great book for you to read. Two, I think I used to look at, you know, women like that. And I think what happened was I read this article. It was like the fuck yes, fuck no article. And it was basically saying, unless you say fuck yes to hanging out with a woman, plus I'm much more cutthroat, I think, when it comes to women than you are. Cause I'm like, if I don't want to hang out with that person, and if it's like someone that's in the middle, then I just really don't spend time, because I think I've come to the point where I do enjoy being by myself. If I have to be by myself, and I enjoy learning, I enjoy working on things on my own. And I would much rather do that than hang out with someone who I have these sort of, you know, as you mentioned, like these intermediate feelings where you enjoy being around them to some extent, but at the same time, it's not like you're like, I'm getting so much out of this on some level. Mm-hmm. And I used to always crave those kind of, you know, those kind of moments. And I used to always find those kind of moments. And since I've stopped, you know, putting myself in those positions, although in Vegas, you know, maybe I may have gotten out of line with those things. And I certainly don't regret many things, but I regretted those out of line moments in Vegas because I've been so good to avoid those times. Uh-huh. And yeah, I think once I just realized that it's sort of wasting your own time and wasting your own potential by spending time with these people that you are just like, you couldn't really care if they're there. If they're there or not there, you're really not going to feel that much different about things.
Right. And it sounds a little bit harsh to word it that way, but I think it's entirely fair. And it's not a knock on the women by any means. It's just, you know, sometimes people just don't connect all that well. In fact, I think most times people just don't connect all that well. So like to kind of hang on to these mediocre connections, I think is unhealthy for me personally. And I'm probably for the people that like I've hung out with in that sense, because you know, if I'm not really into it, then it can't be like a really beneficial experience for you. Mm-hmm. And you're probably not all that into it either. And, you know, I'm really fine with people so like casually hanging out and hooking up, and I'm all for that. I just, you know, like don't think it's a good thing for me to do very often. I just need a lot more time to work on myself, be happy with being alone, and using that time productively.
So how do you think that changed? So you said you were in Tahoe for a couple months at the beginning of the year. How did that change? How did that get to a point, or has it changed, or is it currently in the process of that happening?
I knew, like I made a conscious decision to change it. I thought, you know, I was very confident that it was drawing on me negatively and that I needed some time to just kind of be on my own, also to be away from my roommates, which, you know, I think they're all great and I enjoy living with them. I'm kind of weak-willed in a lot of ways, which is part of the reason that I just like don't go and sit for hours and play cash. But it definitely affects my dieting, where when I'm on my own, like in Tahoe, it's like, and you know, I had a couple people stay with me. Benefield and his girlfriend stayed with me for like most of the first month and a half. And then one of my buddies, Steve Levy, stayed with me for like the second part. But we're just all like on the same page from a dietary standpoint, where we just have like natural good foods, and that's your only choice. So when that's your only choice, it becomes very easy to eat well. Whereas with my current roommates, like some of them have some garbage in the house, and when I just walk by cookies, it's like I'm going to eat them. So kind of removing myself from that distraction was also really healthy. And yeah, so, you know, being in South Lake Tahoe, it's a very male dominant town, and I met some great females there and, you know, developed some good friendships, but still it was like understood that I'm going to go snowboard every day because I want to do that. I think it's really good for me and I'm being active. I'm going to play poker. I was playing a little bit on WSOP. I played a little bit in the on the weekends in Reno. And so I'm just going to do this all the time. And then when we both have time for each other, great. But I just definitely put myself first more than I had in a long time.
Hmm. Was Benefield trying to get you to play basketball every day?
Nah, there's no really – I mean, I'm sure there are places to play. But, you know, it was more of we went snowboarding probably – I probably went 3 or 4 days a week, and he went almost that much. He really fished it. I bought the season pass for like $500 a couple months before, and I told him, buy this pass, buy this pass, buy this pass, and he never did, and then it goes away, then you just have to spend like $100 every time you want a snowboard. So I think that kept he and his girl from snowboarding quite as often as I did. But it was a great time. I mean, I'm probably going to go back this winter. So if you ever want to come up, Tahoe is just like the greatest place to chill.
That would be fun. I've never really done much outdoor stuff in my life. I did a little bit in Vancouver when I was up there, but outside of that, I haven't really been up in like a mountain setting ever. So
is that a one piece jumpsuit?
It could be. No, it's not. It's this is what happened. So I woke up at 2. I woke up an hour before the pod, or 45 minutes, and I put these Adidas pants on, and then I found this Nike hoodie along the way walking, and then that was it. I was like, beautiful. I love this. One of my favorite hoodies. So that was it.
I mean, I'm a huge fan. I was kind of hoping it looks very, you know, like my Italian, like my older Italian loves that shit.
I don't know how to do the Italian. I think that's like a Spanish Italian. how the fuck do you do the Italian thing again? It's like, hands, right? And
it's a lot of hands. I don't even have it, and I can't just like do an accent on the spot, so I don't even try.
I can do a Spanish accent, but I don't know the Italian accent yet.
Yeah, for some reason,
was a one piece actually. That'd be pretty comfortable.
Yeah, like a velour jumpsuit looks good.
So you mentioned that you were snowboarding, you were putting yourself before. So it sounds like in the past that when you've sort of put these interactions with women or what they want to do ahead of maybe what you want to do.
Yeah. You know, it's not like I didn't want to like hang out with like these different girls. I don't know. It just kind of like became routine and not something that I like looked forward to in the way that I probably should have. And it wasn't like something where it's like, all right, like I'm going on this like weekend vacation. You should come with me. So like there's a couple girls that I really did like a lot and that I did like invite to Tahoe for a weekend. But for the most part, it was like, I'm going away or like I'm going to do this thing. So I'll see when I get back. Like I just didn't like want to spend a lot of time with these girls. So yeah, I just, you know, it should have become clearer to me earlier than it did, that it wasn't like the most helpful situation. So we're done with that for now anyway. And actually like, you know, getting a little bit more productive. But yeah, I don't know. I was actually talking to some people a few nights ago. All right. So I went over to Liv, Bree, and Igor's place that they rented for the summer. And there's a bunch of poker players over there. Everyone just kind of like hanging out, end of the summer hangout. And I forget who I was talking to Tony Dunce, because Tony and I have very similar like dating habits, I suppose. And I was telling him how whenever I see someone like around my age that either is wearing a wedding ring or has been with a girl for say like 4 or 5 years or more, I always ask them about their relationship because I genuinely want to learn like what that's like, because I do want that. At some point, it just like feels so impossible for me right now. But I ended up talking quite a bit to Donnie Stern about he and his wife's relationship. I was inspired, you know. It's like, it's nice to hear like just how in love they are and how, you know, things work for them, how they really just love living together. And I think I want that one day. I don't know what you want. But for now, it seems like being in an exclusive relationship would be nearly impossible for me.
I think that idea of this perfect, great relationship, I feel like it might be hard for somebody like me or somebody like yourself to get around, because I feel like we're sort of similar in that we've, you know, we probably spent time with a larger amount of women, and I think it's just hard to. And a lot of people in the chat are like, "All right, you know, guys, come on, you get too many." All right, guys, calm down. Okay, you guys, you know, you guys, maybe you can't meet some people. Meet some people can meet women, and trying to factor that and figure that out is its own process. Okay. You guys, I know you're trying to meet that first woman, and that's cool. Shout out to you guys. Good luck with that, man. But now you get to listen to this specific conversation, this specific take on it. But I think it's just hard to, I know for myself, it's hard to picture that as well, because I think you have so many of these really great short interactions with so many people that once things start getting to a point where there's some struggle or there's some downs, then you start thinking about, well, I could be out there meeting people so easily and I know I'd have a great time with them. So why am I putting myself through this, you know, this months long period of time where I'm just not feeling that super high that I know I can feel, and I could feel it pretty easily sort of thing. So I think that is very hard for me to sort of get past at this point in time.
Yeah, I think I'm definitely the same way, but even like I've met some really amazing girls. Like I've had, I think like two or three girlfriends that I regret parting ways with. But even in that time where it's like, you know, you're great. Like I don't know why I'm not super into this. You know, I just like didn't know for a while. And a lot of it was just kind of wanting that diversity where it's like, you're amazing, but I really miss that interaction that you're talking about of like kind of like just meeting somebody. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, I don't want to get like too crude on here, but like also that, you know, like that sexual interaction where it's like that first time is just always going to be like maybe not like the best sexual experience, but from like a connecting level, you really can't replicate that.
Right.
So it's definitely difficult to not think about that. And for me, it kind of would like ruin my relationships where
sure.
It's like, okay, like I'm not ready to give that up. So it's like, we've been together 6 months, 8 months, a year, whatever. And I'm not cheating on you. I never would, but I'm not ready to be like, okay, you're the only person I'm going to have sex with. So if that's how I feel, then why are we even doing this right now? And I think that was a really immature look on exclusive relationships or just relationships in general, because I think you can find people that kind of understand that and maybe work out, you know, arrangements or deals like to kind of keep both people interested in that way. But still, like it just, that was my mindset. It's like, okay, well, I'm clearly not ready to marry you and just like shut down all other women for life. So why are we doing this? Like, break it off.
It's kind of funny. I feel like you're in my head kind of talking exactly what I was thinking during my last two relationships where like I would enjoy it to some extent, but at the same time, I'm always thinking about like, man, do I really want to be with one fucking person when you can have all the, like, I just can really never get over that. And yeah, I mean, I guess it is maybe immaturity to some extent, but maybe it goes away. I think it's gotten differently the way I think about it as I've gotten older. But at the same time, I don't know, man. I just don't feel it like ending anytime soon. As you mentioned, like that first time, that those first couple moments you have with a new person is just like, it's like a fucking amazing thing. And
yeah, it's like a drug in a lot of ways.
It kind of is. It really is.
There's you know, it elicits the same, you know, like responses in your brain. So yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of like, I'm just hoping that like my drive for that, or that my overall priorities change at some point, because, you know, I don't need like a boring life by any means. Like I'm not looking for that, but you know, the white picket fence has its appeal. My parents are amazing. They've been together for, you know, 34 years. And I would like to have kids and raise them and, you know, be a good dad, do the whole family thing. And I'm really looking forward to that. I can't do it yet.
But dude, I've been meeting a lot of women lately who talk about this open relationship. Mm-hmm. And the idea of being very emotionally connected with you or with someone, but being physically connected with other people as well. And right. Have you met a lot of people that are into that, or have you thought about doing something like that?
Yeah, I mean, I've talked to Kate about it a fair amount, Because I'm, like I said, I'm just really interested in other people's relationships when I think that they're healthy. So for instance, like Donnie and his wife, it's like, I think like they really love each other. That's really healthy. I want to know about that. I want to learn. And Kate has a very different relationship or relationships, but like she also seems like really healthy and I want to learn about that. So there are definitely more people open to it now, or at least I'm meeting more people open to that. And I've never tried it in like a really like deep relationship sense where it's like, okay, we're boyfriend and girlfriend, but we're going to kind of explore and do this. And I imagine that it would have a lot of difficulties and like stressors on the relationship, but maybe not. I mean, you know, I think it's, it kind of just comes down to who you're with and that connection. And I don't know if I'll ever meet like that perfect woman for me, but you know, I'm less worried about it than I have been in the past. I feel like I'll just figure it out eventually.
Yeah, I don't know how I would be in it either, dude. Like the idea, I mean, I don't know. It sounds maybe enjoy it. Maybe like on the surface, it sounds crazy, but once you get to that 1 or 2 month standpoint and then you can still have these open relationships, but be with, so like maybe the idea of being with other people is what hurts relationships that we might get in. But if we had the option to have that not be the case, then maybe the relationships could work better. I mean, yeah, I've never tried. I really haven't thought about it too much until I met someone who talked about it a lot in Vegas, actually.
Yeah, I read or I listened to an audiobook called Mating in Captivity that is a really interesting book, and I would recommend it for anyone that's kind of going through this internal struggle, especially if you're already in a relationship or you kind of err toward serious relationships, because it makes a lot of great points about how we used to be grounded as humans by our family and this like large extended family that we lived with, you know, 10, 20, 30,000 years ago. And then we were kind of, we had that grounding, we had that emotional support, and we had it from, you know, dozens of people, if not more. And then we were kind of able to explore sexually out of that and kind of almost disconnect the two in a lot of ways. Whereas now with these, you know, exclusive or monogamous relationships that our recent society has kind of not forced us into, but you know, definitely like pushed us toward, we really rely on our partner for a lot. You know, we rely on one person, not just to excite us sexually, but also to be our ground and our support system. And all of these things, it used to be accomplished by dozens of people. So I think it does make it very difficult to be in a monogamous relationship. But, you know, the book had some interesting insights as to kind of ways to be aware of that and then to help, you know, navigate it in a monogamous setting. I just don't know if I'm, you know, if it's good enough for me right now.
What's the name of the book called?
Mating in Captivity.
I'm getting some good book recommendations lately. Burns, yeah. On Twitch says, here's a good book to read, The Purpose Driven Life. How many good books out there?
That's a great title for me. Feels like I could use some more purpose.
This book literally changed my life after the 40-day period. Take it into consideration.
Okay.
You hear about the prop that I made last night, Dan, with Fedor on the podcast?
I did. I read that's something.
What do you think about that? So, guys, for, I don't know, me and Fedor, I made a bet last night. I can't masturbate for the rest of the year. So, five months and about 10 days. And I bet my $3,000 to his $9,000.
I think I would need to bet more. I think like 30 to 10 might get me to do it. But I think that would also kind of go against my, you know, like being alone stance, where I'd be so incentivized to go out and hook up with other girls. Yeah, I mean, that would be, I think, a very difficult thing. Good luck. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. 9,000. I mean, yeah.
Here's what I'm thinking, Dan, and you might be the person I can actually even talk to you on the podcast about this one that is going to fucking understand where I'm coming from, what I'm thinking, because I think that porn and masturbation from, and this guy's where this is a Poker Life podcast, but this stuff relates to my own poker existence. Okay. This stuff relates to poker.
It's all part of the GTO Ingram package.
It's all part of everything, man. Even for Dan, I'm sure Dan figuring this out is going to maybe make his ability to get better at poker, focus on poker, learn poker, work harder at poker. It's probably gonna have a positive impact on himself and on his results.
I hope it does. Please tell me.
I think so. But I think that, you know, masturbation and porn has maybe taken an effect on the way that I might view women, maybe the way I view relationships, maybe the way I view sex with different people for the negative. And I'm hoping that not only will I be able to make some money for myself, but also it's a fun challenge. I've done crazy challenges in the past with poker. I've never really done something like this with my actual self. And I think it is something that if I can do, it will be able to help me do other things, help me stay disciplined, be able to take that discipline into other things in my life that I'm trying to gain some more discipline for. I think it'll be kind of fun because, I mean, I just think it'll be fun. I feel like I waste too much goddamn time masturbating. I swear to God, I feel like I just spend way too much time and it just, I just can be doing other things. And I don't really get that. It's said to be a healthy thing. Maybe it does relieve stress, sure. But yeah, I don't know. We'll see what happens, right?
Yeah. I mean, I would like to take that challenge. I would probably want to bet more money. But yeah, I think the discipline part of it is probably the biggest aspect that would be beneficial, because obviously it takes a lot of discipline to kind of like overcome those like sexual desires. But to kind of like you be able to harness that and utilize it for other aspects of your life, I think is super important. That's one of the things that I'm very undisciplined. I'm very just willing to do what is, you know, satisfying in the moment. And that might sound like either I'm jerking off or like going to party, but really most of the time it's just like hanging out. It's like, okay, or play this card game or what have you. But instead it's like, I'm just going to relax and do essentially nothing. And that, you know, that's like one of the downsides of having so much freedom in poker is that all the time. And sometimes having too much choice can be a problem. I actually read, there's a book that's, I think Benefield may have recommended, or maybe it was Liv Bousquet, or neither. But it's called The Paradox of Choice. And I didn't actually read it. Oh no, you know what? It's my buddy Justin, who's one of the producers on the podcast. It's called The Paradox of Choice. And it's one of those things where I don't think you really have to read it. I actually just read the extract on it, or the abstract, from getabstract.com, or you can use like Blinkist is a iPhone app where you can kind of get 15-minute summaries of books. And I read almost entirely nonfiction, and a lot of times like all you need is 15 minutes and you save yourself like 12 or 20 hours of reading. And I got a fair amount from that abstract in just kind of having too much choice for myself and not really like focusing on any one thing. Mm-hmm. And one of the most, you know, I guess powerful or impactful quotes that I have heard actually came from JC Alvarado, where it's not his quote, but he used it in his preparation for his fight against Liv B. And it was, seek freedom and become captive of your desires. Seek discipline and find your liberty. And they're just like, it has never been anything that's spoken to me more. It's like, I just want freedom all the time. It's like, I just want to be able to do what I want to do always. And what it's left me with is like not much to show for it. Like, I've had a great time, but I'm still regretful about the things that I feel like I should have been working toward. Whereas, you know, in the last few months, I've been a lot better about being disciplined. And, you know, a lot better for me is probably still fairly undisciplined to most of people that are listening, but it's still a lot better for me. And I feel a lot better about myself for it. And I'm hoping that I can, you know, kind of continue on that path.
Dazzle on Twitch says, an abundance of choice is completely paralyzing. I feel like you're sort of speaking exactly the way a lot of things I'm thinking too, because that's been one of my biggest challenges too, is just figuring out how to, like you said, too many choices is sort of, I mean, you have so many options. You have so many things you can pursue, so many things you can work at. And that's sort of why I really love poker. And that's why I've loved poker. And maybe playing poker all the time for the past 8 years has almost had a negative impact, because with poker, it's pretty easy. You sit down, you play poker. Like, that's what it is. If I want to get out of bed and I want to play online poker, I go sit on my computer, I play online poker. It's very easy. And right. you can work on your game outside of that. But for the most part, you're playing poker. That's what you do. And when you start factoring in, like, you know, that's just one thing. That's what you do. When you start factoring in these other things you could be doing, it's a lot different than just poker for me. And the one thing I found that's similar is basketball. You go to the gym, you play basketball. You work on your game, you get better at basketball. Like, it's fairly straightforward to some degree. But when it comes to a lot of other things, like, there's just so many options, so many choices. And I really need to read that book, because that's the thing. And that's kind of what you mentioned about discipline. That's what I'm hoping this bet might do, is just make me more disciplined to just, you know, figure that out. That's the thing I want to figure out, the most aspect of discipline.
Yeah. I think another aspect of poker that can be bad for me is that there's really no path. Like, you can kind of create a path and make yourself, I want to be able to go from these stakes to these stakes, and you kind of like chart that. But for me, it's like, I just haven't had the desire to be rich in the last, like, say, almost 10 years, where, you know, it'd be nice. Of course, I'd love to win a lot of money, but it hasn't been like a driving force for me. Mm-hmm. And it's always easy to just go sit and play like 5-10 and beat it. Like, online, obviously very different, but I can't imagine the 5-10 game that I'm not going to make like $100 an hour. They just like rarely exist. So you kind of always have this safety net where it's like, oh, I can just go play. But it's not like like a regular job where, even if you're, say, like working as a store clerk, which isn't, you know, the most like ambitious career, it's like, okay, well, then I can be the manager, and then I want to move on to this and this. And you kind of have, at least in your head, like this path of upward mobility. Whereas in poker, it's like, yeah, you can create that, but it's kind of like the bottom rung, or at least like my bottom rung, is like pretty darn good. It's like, you know, right, I can just do this for a while. But it's also short-sighted, because if I want to have a family, like, just having an okay amount of money and playing 5-10 is a terrible plan. And you never know where poker is going to go. I mean, it's gotten a lot harder. And it might be, you know, 5-10 might be nearly unbeatable for like any amount of like real money in 10 years. Right. And so 10 years from now, if I'm at that point, it's like I could be at serious risk of having a hard life. And I just can't have that.
I guess that's kind of why a lot of people have the goal of setting themselves up for something outside of poker. Like, you've done the sponsorships, you've made yourself, you know, visible in the poker community to the point where you get sponsored, or you make money off of yourself. And I think that's what more people are doing now. I think more people are really starting to think about, as games get harder, the economy sort of changes in the online world. I think more people are now thinking about, how can I set myself up outside of poker? Like, what can I start doing with my time that just isn't playing poker?
Yeah. And another great thing about poker that I think that maybe we know, but we don't take full advantage of, is you can work on pretty much anything you want to work on while still playing a pretty reasonable poker schedule.
Right.
I mean, a lot, especially live players, like, a lot of them don't play more than 30 hours a week. And you can find 30 hours a week to play and then have plenty of time to work on whatever you want to work on your own. I mean, whether it's like, like going to school or taking on like some sort of other job that you enjoy and you have like a, you know, a path or a vision for, or just like writing your screenplay or whatever like dream you've had for a long time, you can do all that while you're playing. It's not like you need to like quit poker and do something else. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge benefit of poker that I know that I haven't taken advantage of, and probably a lot of people haven't, where it's kind of an excuse like, oh, you know, when I stop playing poker, I'll do this. But you just don't have to make that choice when you're in that position.
Do you have some sort of dream?
I don't know, man. I really don't know. Like, a lot of the things that I'm like passionate about are very difficult to achieve, and therefore it's easy to just like not do them. So I mean, I like writing. You know, I would like to write a screenplay at some point, but maybe I'd be really bad at it. I don't know. I like to do some stand up. I think, you know, it's funny. I actually get, I don't know if you're like this at all, but if I see a guy like Bill Burr or who's that kid that I like? Bo Burnham, Louis C.K. Like I see these comedians and I'm not inspired because they are amazing and I don't think that I could ever achieve like what they've achieved. But then I'll see someone like, I feel bad even like using some of their names. But like, I don't know, Kathy Griffin I've seen. Pretty much like almost any other comedian. Like there are just like so many awful comedians. And I see them and I'm inspired. Because it's like, you guys are awful. And you're touring the country and making all this money. And I don't see like why anyone is laughing at your jokes. So I think I'm much more inspired by people that are awful at things than the ones that are like truly the greats. And yeah, like I wouldn't mind doing some writing in that sense. I'm actually really passionate about healthcare, which is kind of a weird thing to be passionate about. But I think that our system in America is a disaster, which is not, you know, an uncommon viewpoint. And I think that I have like a lot of reasonable ideas about how to fix that. But it's like, where do I start? You know, it's just a really, you know, absurd mountain to kind of take on as a topic. And in order to, like, I don't see any money in it. Like, I just have a lot of like these grandiose dreams that don't really get anywhere. So I think I need to just actually start with something achievable and kind of take those steps and have that like positive reward system of achieving something. And I think fighting chance is a good start. You know, it's not like my stand-up special by any means, but I think it's good. And it's something that was an idea of mine that I made happen and people are enjoying. Mm-hmm. And that is, you know, more than I can say about really anything I've done in the last 15 years.
Interesting stuff right there, Dan. Interesting stuff. Did you ever think you had a dream? Did you ever have a dream growing up that you had, or a poker dream or anything like that?
Yeah. I mean, when I first started playing cards, I wanted to play with the guys that were on TV.
Same.
You know, it's like, and it's in that sense, I mean, there's one kid, and I mentioned it in the podcast, I think actually in the episode that's coming out today, they like get into a little bit more of like kind of our stories and coming up, Kate and myself. And there was a kid that when I first started playing online, my third semester of college, we used to hang out every single night and people would go to bed usually around like 2 a.m., 3 a.m. and we would smoke weed and stay up until noon the following day. And it should be, you know, kind of easy to realize that I just didn't go to class at all for this entire period of my life. Mm-hmm. And we smoked and played, like I was probably playing still 25, 50, maybe $50, but for like 8, 9, 10 hours straight, all the way up until noon. And then I'd go to sleep. And all we wanted back then was to be able to like play these big tournaments. And there was like an opportunity my junior year of college to go study abroad somewhere. And it was like, you know, I like my college friends. I enjoy this. And I'm going to go travel to Europe when I can play these like 10Ks. Like that was my dream. And I haven't talked to that kid in forever. I don't even know where to find him. But he kind of reminds me that I have accomplished something. Because you do, you know, I, at least me, I start to get a little self-loathing when I think about all the things that I should and could have done. But, you know, at that time, like it, like what I'm doing now was my dream. So I'm living my dream from 10 years ago, at least. Mm-hmm. I guess like 13, 14 years ago, which is nice. But like, I think my dream has evolved a bit. But yeah, you know, like in those moments when like we just grinded and grinded and made, you know, a few hundred bucks a day and cashed out like, you know, 500 bucks like every other day. It was like we were just living the dream and we wanted all these things. And now when I sit down at a poker table with Negreanu, it's like, we talk about, like, you know, politics or the weather. You know, it's not like, oh, like Daniel. But, you know, in 2004, when I was watching Negreanu win the Player of the Year, it was like, oh, Daniel. Mm-hmm. So I guess, you know, I've achieved a fair amount in that sense, but just not, you know, as much as I know I'm capable of.
So I guess it's trying to figure out what the next dream might be.
Yeah, and I think – and I'm – it's kind of sick, but I played the Venetian 5K tournament because it's a 5K, and it's pretty decent, and there's a lot of money to be won. And I ended up busting two bullets, and that was my last shot at, like, making any good chunk of money this summer. Instead, I lost $10,000 in a couple days, which is really annoying. But when the last card fell, I got an ace-king to aces, just like I never had a chance. But I flopped a king, and so I had outs on the river. And when the last card was not another king, I wasn't immediately disappointed. I was relieved. It was just like, okay, like I can just stop this for now. And I think that is kind of in line with tournaments being kind of like a, you know, this like drug, like this heroin, this dragon that you keep chasing, where while you're doing it, it's really hard to make plans elsewhere. Because you can always make $500,000 in a week. And once, like, you let that dream die, even if it's only for a month, like for the next month I'm doing almost nothing until the Hard Rock tournament in August, now I can start to kind of examine my life, like count up how much money I have left and kind of develop a plan going forward, both financially and emotionally and like healthfully. So that was kind of my – you know, my initial reaction to busting that tournament. And maybe that means that I should be playing a lot less tournament poker.
I mean, it could be a combination of things. It could be a combination of maybe you shouldn't be playing. Maybe you should, maybe it's just the time, the summer. I mean, Vegas is intense. The World Series of Poker is an intense thing. It's 6 weeks. You live in Vegas, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, fuck, it's intense. I think that's a pretty normal feeling to have, especially if you end up down money. I think that's like a normal thing. You just want to take a break. You want it to end, and you don't want the options to be so readily available for you right there.
Yeah. And the last 2 weeks, even during the main, like I just wasn't as mentally healthy as I would have liked to have been. And it wasn't like, I'm sure it had a negative impact on my play. But I don't think it was much. I mean, I think I played really well, and I definitely, you know, every day I was there, I wanted to play and I wanted to win. But on my off days, I was having a really tough time. Just like hardly able to get out of bed, just like not really any like motivation to do anything. And I think a lot of it had to do with my diet, where just like for a month, the first month of the World Series, like I went hard. I played a lot of poker. I did a fair amount of partying when I could, and I ate well and things were good. And then the last 2 weeks or so, I just started to go off the hinges a bit. Mm-hmm. Like everything kind of piled up. I was disorganized. I just wasn't like doing the little things that you kind of need to do to keep yourself sane for this 6 or 7 week period. And I started to eat really bad food. And then from there, just like spiraled out of control. And I'm just like, now I've lost 6 pounds in the last 36 hours just from not eating trash, which, you know, goes to show you like just how awful like fast food is and like a lot of processed foods. And I'm just like, I already feel a lot better mentally. And I'm just looking forward to like making good dietary choices, good physical choices, and kind of getting a plan, a little bit of a routine back. Right. Because after a while, you just like, I mean, I think for a lot of people, you just start to lose your mind.
Yeah, I think in Vegas especially, it's hard to get it back during the series because once you get off of it, it's hard to, I mean, it's not, maybe it sounds easy to some people, but it's challenging for sure. It's challenging to just get back on that rhythm, get back in that routine. Paul Bish on YouTube says, can't believe you compared poker to heroin. Obviously you've never done or been addicted to heroin. If you want to appreciate your life, retrospectively become a heroin addict. Now I've actually talked about a potential heroin prop bet, by the way, as a joke. And a lot of people got back to me on the dangers of a heroin prop bet. And, I've researched heroin a lot and the effects and, although I maybe it's not as extreme, I think that I mean, it's certainly on the path. The way that you can feel from poker, the way you can feel from playing these tournaments or cash games or gambling, I mean, it could be just as bad as something like heroin, honestly. It's certainly on the path. If it's not up there, it's certainly for some. And for some, I'd argue that it could be just as strong, if not more.
Yeah, I don't think I really reasonably implied that I was, you know, judging heroin addiction in any way, because I don't know what it is. But I was really just saying that from what I've heard in heroin and maybe some of those other drugs, it's like that first high is what you're chasing. And it's really difficult to achieve it. And so a lot of times you end up doing it more or taking more of it to kind of try to achieve that high. And I think tournament poker scores are relatable in that way, where like, you know that like there's no way to win a few hundred thousand dollars in a week unless you're playing a tournament, mm-hmm. you know, for someone of my stake level. And you remember how great that feels, and you want that feeling of not just winning the money, but then afterwards of like having all this money that you know, didn't really work that hard for, and having the ability to do whatever you want with it. So that is something that I think is, you know, fairly comparable, you know, in an analogy sense. No, I don't know what heroin is like, and I'll never know, because I think only like 5% of people get addicted to it. It's something like much smaller than you would have thought, but it's still something that it's like when I'm feeling down, when I like, you know, I feel depressed, I don't really want to do anything. It's like, and I'm self-loathing where I kind of like want to hurt myself. Me hurting myself is like smoking weed and eating McDonald's. And that's bad enough. But that's like, you know, that's like as bad as it gets for me. And I'm okay with that. Whereas, you know, if I even tried heroin and that became a thing that I could actually do when I was not in a good place, I think that would be a real danger and something that I just don't need to have as an option in my life.
I don't think many people need heroin as an option in their life, man.
No, I think that's a fair statement.
Although that was kind of the prep bit. Could I do it and not become addicted to it? I still think I could. But I mean, many people have advised me do not do the bet. So,
well, I mean, at least like if you lose the bet, then the money doesn't really matter. It's just like, well, your life is fucked, so whatever. But if you win the bet, you just ultimately win because nothing really happened and you get all this money. So it's like you're really pressing your luck there.
Yeah, it does not seem like a very GTO approach to things. Yeah, I'm going to give you one question. I'm going to grab some water here real quick from my sink here. Let me find one of these good questions in chat. And by good questions in chat, I mean certainly could be some Jungle Man. Is that you? Yeah, you do kind of have a little Jungle Man look to you. But like a little bit like more prettier than Jungle Man, though. Not saying Jungle Man is not pretty, but like a little bit more like take care of yourself a little bit more than Jungle Man does.
I think that I got my hair cut a little bit shorter than I would have liked, which kind of makes my head look rounder because I have a big head. I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't really know what Jungle Man looks like. I mean, I've seen him, but I can't like picture it, you know, in the moment. But maybe we do look like – I look a lot like Jeremy Osmus.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, I can see that, yeah.
Whenever we're together, people ask if we're related. And skinny Matt Salzberg and I have a lot of facial like similarities as well.
Skinny Matt Salzberg, huh?
Actually, even Fat Salzberg, Facebook – like in its facial recognition would confuse us on occasion. And now that he's lost, like he said, 50 pounds, he actually tweeted earlier today. I was texting with him yesterday, a little bit about diet. But he lost 50 pounds, which is awesome. And something that he like gets shit for somehow. Because people say that he's not as funny now that he's skinny, but it's one of those things where I think we should really applaud his effort and like make him feel good about that. That's a really, really hard thing to do. And the fact that he's
kind of an asshole to people on Twitter. So I can understand if people aren't ready to applaud him for anything he does.
I don't know. I mean, occasionally he's harsh, but for the most part, you know, I think he's like pretty fair and comical. But you know,
I certainly know some people who don't think who think he may be comical, but very much mean spirited with some of his comments.
I disagree that it's mean spirited. I truly don't think that it is. But I think that some of it, you know, outside of like him being aware, is wrong, or you know, something that I don't think is like appropriate behavior or really all that funny. And we talked, you know, a couple weeks ago, he had said a couple things that I thought was like really not funny because it's just like overdone over and over at the same person. And it's like, it really just like amounts to bullying after a while. And, you know, I was pretty vocal about that. So I think Matt and I can have our disagreements, but still, you know, respect one another.
All right, here's the question I'm going to give you. I'm going to grab some water. Why did you stop streaming on Twitch? Boom, go from there.
I like streaming on Twitch, you know. It's a fun thing for me to do, but it takes a lot of time and commitment. And to do it for hours per day, you know, 5 or 6 days a week is just a huge use of my time. And I just wasn't making any money from it. I mean, I made like a little bit from some sponsorship deals and from actually winning on World Series, but there aren't any big games going. And even the 2-5 games, I mean, you know, some players are bad, but some of them are pretty darn decent. And the decent ones and the good ones are watching my stream and figuring out, you know, the things that I'm doing that are not GTO and exploiting me for them. And it just like isn't a great way for me to make money. So while I appreciate, you know, the fans that I had, the people that actually watched on a daily basis, and I love that interaction, and it was difficult for me to leave and kind of do my last like scheduled stream in December. You know, just like you just have to make a decision at some point where I just don't think that this is worth my time. And, you know, like I said, I really did enjoy it, but it's just something that it's work, you know, it's a job, and it's hard to kind of keep up a job where you're not making nearly enough money as you could doing other projects that you might even enjoy more. So if I get like, you know, if at some point like poker comes back to say California and there's a good customer base and people actually want to learn or want to watch more, and I can get a few thousand viewers every time I'm streaming, awesome. You know, I can make money doing that. I would enjoy doing that, and I would be able to work on my game a lot. But until that happens, it's just like, you know, to stream for a few hundred people, it's like, yeah, I really appreciate those people, but I'm spending 15 or 20 hours a week streaming a game, giving away what I'm doing, and making very little money for it. Just didn't make economic sense.
Yeah, I guess it's like a long-term thing. It takes a long time to build up that audience to get to be a couple thousand people. And is it worth it in the meantime when you're playing in these games with these players who are watching information and those type of things? I mean, that's why people always say, why don't you stream PLO? I mean, like, that's like one of the dumbest things ever. If you're streaming, you know, 5, 10, 10, 20 PLO against player, like people that are in your game are going to be seeing you. They're going to be like, that's a very bad thing. I mean, I don't know, like, sure, there's some people like, you know, like, I guess like one, you know, Doug Polk does it. Doug, so he's like the one person that does it. And, you know, to him, he's got enough money. He doesn't care. He can still make money in the games or whatever. But
yeah,
I think for most people, they're like, that's just going to be fucking crazy. Super minus EV for you to stream your cash games if you're playing. I mean, even if you're playing, I mean, I guess it gets to a point if you're playing small stakes, but then at the same time, why are you going to spend your time playing small stakes when you can just play off stream and play higher stakes?
Yeah. It's just like, it's a really crazy thing. I mean, if you are, like, let's say Jamie Staples, who I don't really know Jamie very well, but people like his stream, he's entertaining, and he plays like fairly small, then like, great, you know, like he's going to make a decent amount of money from streaming from stars, and he's not really like giving away that much because he's kind of inexperienced himself. So like, you know, good for him.
Well, plus the stream's paying for the tournaments. So if the stream is paying for your cash games, it could be a different story.
Right. Exactly. And then, you know, like Jay Carver obviously just crushes it. And that's, you know, on a totally different level where his stream is his income and what he's doing in these tournaments is like pretty irrelevant. But yeah, you know, when you're not at that level, then, you know, it's just, it doesn't really make much economic sense. And it's hard to get there. It really is. I tried. I think I did a decent job with my show. Yeah, I could have done better, but you know, my show was at least like 80% of what I thought it could be. Mm-hmm. And my viewership just wasn't enough to continue. And it's like I'm playing on bullshit sites in Nevada, mostly playing just 2-5. And you don't really have that, you know, it's like people who are watching these games, they watch for kind of the same reason that we play tournaments, because occasionally it's really exciting. You get to play for a lot of money. And in Nevada, you can never do that because the tournaments are like $100 and you might win 10,000 almost never. So it's just, you just really can't create that same buzz in the States right now, unfortunately.
Killabug on Twitch says, I streamed 1020 PLO for a while. Yes, I loved when you streamed 1020 PLO, Killabug. That was one of the, yes. Anytime you stream 1020 PLO, it encouraged me to play 1020 at the same time, because if there's somebody in the game giving away their how they think in their cards, it actually, got to be honest, it actually gave me a lot of perspective on how other players that are American think about Bovada PLO, by the way. So I do appreciate that. Thank you for the insight.
Right, exactly. It's like you gained so much from that. And
I honestly did. I swear to God, I probably that was probably worth a couple $1,000s, the amount of just like insight that I gained during those couple of streams that he did.
Yeah, and like people that I'm playing with are watching my stream and even talking in my chat. It's like, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I'm putting the information out there. It's on me to not do it. It's not on them to like shun it for some reason. Mm-hmm. So I'm just giving all of this away and they're just using it. And that's, you know, I don't blame them for that at all. I think they should like tell me who they are. Like someone the other day was like, oh, I played with you in the bracelet event the other day. And I was like, oh, what's your name on there? Like, oh, I'm not going to tell you that. It's like, okay, well then why are you even fucking talking to me? It's just like, if you know who I am on there and you want to like engage this in conversation, then tell me what your name is, or like, don't even bring it up. You know, like, I don't understand like the desire to kind of keep that information like entirely hidden and like have some sort of relationship with someone.
Yeah. Albin says, it's simple, to be honest. Me as a European viewer, almost only watch streamers that play on PokerStars.
Yeah. And that's entirely reasonable. And I don't think, I mean, I would have to do a lot of work to beat 2-5 Zoom on Stars. I mean, like I've played it when I've gone away for like W Cooper Scoop. And I thought that I was beating the game. Like, you know, I was very confident that I could profit playing 2-5. And then I heard about the bet that Timex made where he actually lost and couldn't beat 2-5.
Right.
Like, well, if Timex isn't beating it with some work, then I imagine I've just been running above expectation. So it's like, I don't really want to do all that work and get a HUD and like deal with these things. Like, that's not fun for me. So I'm not going to go on there and play cash games. And am I going to leave the States just to play like tournaments on Stars and stream them? Like, I just don't see why I would do that.
Yeah, I guess what other options are there? You know, what other options could you do for yourself in poker, on the business side of poker, to I guess make money for yourself then?
Yeah, I mean, hey, who knows? Maybe the podcast will take off. The good thing about these podcasts, I mean, I think it's a little tougher for us right now, right? We've been on the air for an hour and a half. And if someone is still watching, like, great job. It's just really hard for me to watch anything for an hour and a half. Like, even a movie is a huge commitment. But, you know, like podcasts, you can make a decent amount of money doing them if you have a lot of listeners. But it's not easy to get all those listeners either. I don't know. How many do you usually have?
Kind of depends. I think most episodes, most of the, I guess, more popular guests are over 10,000 views on YouTube, and then a couple thousand downloads on iTunes right now. And I guess I've never been obsessed with views. I've never looked into views. And then once, I guess, more popular guests are 20, 30, 40,000 right now. And, but I've never really I've never cared about the views. I care about the hardcore engagement with the audience that does watch my stuff. And if I can connect with them and get those people to exist, then more views come naturally. Like, I'm never worried about views. If the content you put out is good, and people find some sort of value from it. Eventually people will find it. It just takes time on some level. Also, it depends on your, you know, your, there's marketing, there's advertising, there's networking. There's so much other stuff behind the scenes that goes into gaining an audience. And that sort of stuff, all that really all matters. And for me personally, I've just sort of done the podcast, and then I still play a lot of poker. I do hustle a lot behind the scenes in terms of just keeping up communication and relationships with certain people. I could be doing probably 85% more on that end, because getting yourself visible on these things, getting yourself on a World Series of Poker stream during the summer, or getting yourself on different podcasts, like, you know, like you've done with yourself, or you're getting yourself on other things that are also going to help you get your name out there to more people. That's all a hustle. That's all.
Yeah.
You have to go out and search and do that and actually get after it. And those sort of things all go back into you having success at what it is you're doing, whether it's a podcast or whether it's a stream. And that's what it is. How hard do you want to work? How hard do you want to hustle? But also, your content's got to be fucking good. If your content's really good, then people will come.
Yeah. And I don't enjoy selling myself at all.
So yeah, I'm the same way.
I did this thing. If you like it, cool. Like, I'm not going to, you know, I'll go on like some podcasts, or I went on the World Series stream and, you know, like promoted my podcast Fighting Chance a bit, but like, I'm not just going to go out there and like be a salesman. I don't enjoy that at all. Actually, that's far too light. Like, I despise doing that. So it's a little bit tougher for me to like market in that sense. And like you said, I mean, obviously like the more people that listen, great, but I just want to create something good, and I'm happy with that as a standalone project. The only reason that views, or I guess listens, really matter to my current podcast is I would like to do more of them. It seems like something that could be good and that I can continue. But when it's a produced podcast like mine is, it costs me like, you know, probably $500 to $700 per episode to put it out.
What are you paying for exactly?
So, you know, Kate and I record our thoughts into our voice recorders. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we record conversations that we have with other people. Sometimes we have conversations between one another, or phone calls, or like with the actual producer. And we have hours of content, and then we give it all to this production team, and then they cut it down into 25-minute episode and like take like the best, like most interesting stuff. And then he narrates it, as well as, like, you know, cleans up the audio, adds music, like makes it into a flowing story. And that takes, you know, probably 20 to 30 hours for them to do per episode. Jesus. So, well, it's, you know, it's like two people working
right.
for like, you know, 10 to 15 hours. And I'm, you know, paying them, you know, like a reasonable salary. So it's, you know, it's just not like turning on a microphone and going. So it takes a little bit of money. And I think that we could probably like get break even if we had like, say, 10,000 listens per episode, which is not ridiculous. And it's something that, if it appeals to mainstream consumers or listeners, then we should be able to do. But as of right now, it's more like half that. And, you know, I just really haven't sold any advertising. You know, we had like a deal with Seminole Hard Rock in Florida, which is really cool of them, to kind of like take us on their team for the summer and, you know, buy advertising space and take a chance on this new kind of poker content. So I'm really appreciative of them. And then I've had some other kind of like small companies help us out. We actually did a deal with Upswing, Doug Polk and Ryan Fee, which was really cool. Kate and I even got some coaching from Ryan, which was really useful. But yeah, that's like pretty much all we've done as far as like marketing goes. And I've been awful about like finding advertisers. I just like, it's like, ah, whatever. Like, they're going to pass a few $100. Like, no big deal. I'll just, you know, not deal with this issue of selling myself. But maybe going forward, if we get some more listens, it'll be a little bit easier.
How much you think 10,000 views are done? How much you think you can get paid from that?
Based on what I saw for like ad rates in podcasts, like a typical, like non-affiliate, like let's say like Burger King might pay like $30 to $40 per thousand. So you might get like $300 or $400 for a 30-second ad like in the middle of your podcast.
I'm doing it all wrong, man.
Yeah, I mean, you can get like a fair amount of money. And that's Burger King. Like, for you, you should be able to demand a lot more money because you have a very targeted audience. Like, you're going to have, you know, the special, like, male, mostly male, like, you know.
18. No, no, Dan, 97% male. That's male.
Okay. For sure. So like, male, like, 18 to 35, where it's a really niche audience, which will cater to, like, some people who want to offer males products. But especially in the gambling world, you know, like, you should be able to get a poker site to pay you, say, like, $80 or maybe, like, $60 to $80 per thousand, because your audience is a lot more targeted and valuable to them. So you could definitely make a reasonable amount of money, like, if you get up into, like, really big views. But like I said, you know, for me, it never would be that much because we actually have to pay to have our episodes done. And yeah, you know, whatever.
Can you do your podcast your own? I mean, I don't know. I feel like you can just figure out what you want to talk about exactly. Instead of recording hours of content, record the type of content that you know that you'll be using for the show.
Yeah, I mean, I might have exaggerated a little bit in that, you know, we give like a relatively specialized amount of content, but still, like, what they do is something that I have no interest in doing. I mean, they're writing the story, which they're going to be better storytellers than I am. And, you know, it's like not like they're writing it out of like fiction, but they're like taking what we have and kind of shaping it into something that is easier to listen to and easier to follow. And they're also, you know, like, listening to all this audio, cutting it down, you know, mastering volumes, like all these things where it's like, it's, I'm paying them a very reasonable amount of money. And I like, you know, I would never want to do it.
That's sort of what goes into your own, if it's like a business in a way, that's what happens. You put hours into your business, you get, you learn. I mean, you might start off and suck at doing this shit, but you get better over time doing it. And yeah. I mean, an easy way to do it is just you create a story that you want to hear. What would you want to hear if you were listening to your own stuff?
No, for sure. I think it's definitely possible. I just, I'm a big fan of delegating and kind of using the market economy. And I don't think that I will be as good at this as they are.
Man, you're trying to pay someone $705. Man, I'll do it for less than that, man. God damn, y'all tripping. It's so, I mean, it's like, that's like the fun part of things is doing that stuff. That's, I mean, I enjoy those sort of things now. I've started to enjoy them more.
Yeah. I mean, maybe I would eventually, but I think that they do a really good job, and it would just, you know, it's not something that I'm interested in. I'm more of like, you know, like big picture, like let me deal with like these things and kind of get, yeah, like, give you ideas.
Point, like it just doesn't start off at that point. It you build it to that point. You build the audience to that point, and then you can delegate the process at that point once it becomes feasible. But if the options don't do it, that seems like, you know, it seems like, I don't know. It doesn't seem like the way to do it. I mean, if the option is don't do it because you can't afford it, or do it for a period of time until you can afford it, which, I mean, I think it's completely possible.
Yeah. I think it's also, you know, I initially planned on this being a standalone project and just being like an 8-episode series about this summer's WSOP. And I'm okay with it just being that. And I don't think that like I have that much. You know, I don't think I can captivate an audience once a week for a year. You know, I just don't think I'm all that interesting. I think the story of being a professional poker player, when told correctly, is interesting. But, you know, I think that there's kind of diminishing returns where...
I disagree with you, by the way.
Okay.
I think you could. I think if you included things we've talked about here, you worked in women, you worked in your poker, you worked in what you're working at. I mean, I think it's fucking interesting. Honestly, I feel like people appreciate and respect your honesty, your openness, the way that you talk about these things. And if that's the sort of thing you were bringing each week, I feel like you'd get people who loved it, who it's unlike anything else that really exists in poker.
Yeah. I mean, I could probably do just like a solo podcast, like kind of like Bill Burr does, where it's just himself talking, and maybe plan it out a little bit. So it's not as, you know, all over the place as his is. But I kind of like to keep my private life as private as possible also, like, which might seem a little bit conflicting with just being open and honest about things. But, you know, like, I don't, like, I'm not going to talk about girls specifically. You know, I don't like to use names. I was actually joking the other day with, it's like, Stam Dog and Ty Raymond, who I don't know Stam very well, but I like him. I think he's a good dude. And I know Ty only marginally better and love Ty. I think he's just like hilarious. Love being around him. But they asked me if I hooked up with this girl that like they knew that I hung out with one night. And I was just like, can't say. And they're like, oh, yeah, I know what that means. So it's like, actually, no, like I'm entirely balanced when it comes to girls, much more so than like my actual poker game, where I'll never say if I did or didn't hook up with someone, because it's just the best way to go, because then like no one can really ever tell. And if it was like, if I were giving hard no's on some people and then like maybes on others, it would be pretty easy to figure out. And I just, you know, I don't want to lie about things, but I also don't really want, especially girls like that people know, right? It's like, this wasn't a girl that's in poker, but like they both knew her. But especially girls like that are in or affiliated with poker, it's like, I'm open and I don't mind talking about it. But especially in current society, it's like girls just get like so much flack for hooking up with anyone. Mm-hmm. And if like the girl wants to talk about it with her friends, like fine, go ahead. But for me, it's like, I'm just like never going to talk about that. And I think that it's just like fairer to the girl that way. And also, I mean, selfishly, I think it's good for like hooking up with girls, because this way, like, you know, people understand that you're respectful of their privacy and like they know that you're just not going to say anything. And if they want to divulge information, they can do that.
So do you think dating or hooking up with girls in the poker world is a smart thing to do?
I don't think I've honestly never really looked at it that way, because it's hard to be rational when you're talking about, you know, emotions, whether it's, you know, mostly sexually driven or more emotionally driven. It's like you're just not going to be rational in that moment anyway. So yeah, it's probably not the best thing to do, but sometimes you meet like some great girls that, you would like to have more of an interaction with, and then things just happen. So yeah, I've made better decisions for sure, but I also have a lot of great, you know, memories and relationships, and even girls that like I hooked up with like once or twice or three times, that like we have a much different, or like we have a much like closer or more intimate relationship now as friends, because we've shared that as well.
So you've been able to stay friends with them then.
Yeah. Like, do you have to have situations like that where you're like just friends with a girl that you've hooked up with in the past? No.
Well, I'm definitely friends with a lot of them on some level, but
yeah, but
I don't think like, we were really ever friends to begin with, you know, like some of the girls. So,
yeah,
but I do find it interesting in the poker world, you sort of stay friends with the girls because they're always around you. Whereas girls that don't play poker that you may have hooked up with, you don't really ever see them. So it there's really wouldn't be opportunity for you to stay friends with them.
Right. Yeah. I guess it is kind of like, you know, like dating in the workplace, where it's probably a bad plan, but like if you're, you know, if you are smart about it, I guess, or like as reasonable of a person as you can be, then typically it's going to be fine afterwards.
Yeah. I'm trying to, I don't know. I've had some experiences with the women in the poker world that, I think it'd be better off to just not do it again, not really date, not just stay away from the women in poker. It just doesn't seem like, it just seems like it, I don't know.
But you know what's great is I don't actually know about like any of those. So like, I think you've probably done a pretty good job just like not running your mouth.
I mean, listen, I got an approach. And I got an approach, Dan, and yeah, it's to have as little people as possible know about a lot of the things. But unfortunately, that might not always be the case.
Right. Yeah. I mean, obviously, things like happen, but yeah, I think that's like the best approach as well. But like, I guess like the problem with it sometimes is that like some piece of information will get out and then get distorted.
Yeah.
And then you have, you know, I don't know. I just had like situations where it's mostly like from guys, believe it or not, like guys just like running their mouths about nonsense, where like I've had guys like actually talk to like girls that I was dating or seen or whatever and be like, oh, stay away from him. Like, he's done this, this, and this. And it's like, I don't even know you. Like, you don't know what you're talking about. You probably just want to hook up with this girl and you're like feeding her this information, which is wrong. And it's just like, it's kind of sad when that stuff happens, but you know, I'm getting really good at not giving a shit, which is nice. It's kind of like this level that you eventually get to where even like the last like couple weeks, I've had like a couple of like Twitter beefs of sorts, I guess. Mm-hmm. And even during those, just like, I'm not ever actually upset. I'm kind of like laughing at the situation and like how ridiculous it is.
Who have you been having Twitter beefs with?
Well, yesterday I was kind of like going off a little bit on the Groot kids because
who?
I don't know. NWO is Groot. They have like an account. I feel almost bad like saying their names because I don't even know, you know, like I don't like know for sure, but like based on what like everyone says, basically it's like Burbick and Hutter and maybe Schindler. And it's funny cause like they just, you know, it's like, I know it's them, but they kind of have this thin veil of anonymity because, you know, they have like this group anonymous account where they just tweet at people and bully them. And it's really like sad and cowardly, but some people think it's funny.
So who do you think they are in real life, by the way? Who'd you say they were?
Well, from what I understand, it's Burbick, Hutter, Schindler. I don't know like how involved some of them are, you know, who is what. And that's why I kind of feel bad because like Jake, for instance, right? Like I like Jake Schindler. I've talked to him a few times. Like I think we got along. Like I thought he was a really good kid. And then I hear that he's like involved with this. And he's also like spouted off like some nonsense to me. Not like much, but like, you know, the occasional like something on Twitter. And it's just like, I don't know where our difference is. And I'd much rather just like get together and talk about this in person. Same with Barry. It's like I talked to Barry in a 3K Caesars event, or like not Caesars, or yeah, like WSOP like circuit event at Planet Hollywood. We played together for like hours and hours and hours, and you know, like we don't see the world the same way, and we're definitely different in some of our beliefs. But it's like, you know, seemed reasonable to me. Like I thought we were talking as like two human beings, and then as soon as SHRPO, the Seminole Hard Rock in Florida, tweeted that Kate and I had joined like their team for the summer, he just like immediately starts talking shit about me on Twitter. It's like, why don't you just like, you know, come talk to me about this, actually like ask a question first before you go just like being bitter for, I don't know why, I really don't. And it's like, it's not in a way where he even really has anything like to say. Like, honestly, like I don't know why he hasn't apologized yet. Like he should be embarrassed, in my opinion, because his initial reaction was, oh, like now I know like we're just like, they're wasting our rake money basically by signing us for the summer. And I don't know exactly what his words were, but he basically implies that, you know, like we're not worth the investment from SHRPO, which is just objectively wrong because we might not be. Like he might be right, but he has absolutely zero information. Like he doesn't know what we're offering because he didn't know about the podcast yet. He doesn't know what they're paying us and still doesn't. And he doesn't know anything about casino marketing. So it's like if you said, hey Barry, I bought this couch, and he said, wow, Joe, that was a really bad decision. And you said, hey Barry, do you know how much this couch costs? Like, oh no, I have no idea. Do you know what the couch looks like? No, I haven't seen it. Do you know anything at all about couches? Like, actually, no, I don't know anything at all about couches. Like, okay, then like, what are you talking about? You literally have no idea what you're talking about. So I think that they just like, for whatever reason, want to get, you know, they just like get annoyed and then spew nonsense on Twitter. And it just like, I don't really care what they say about me, but I think they've done some really awful things. And after a while, I just like, I'm just over dealing with it.
Yeah, I don't know much about those guys. I don't really know much about what they've done or who they have relationships with, anything like that.
Yeah, they're just like, they're pretty bitter and hateful. And again, like, I almost like feel bad like lumping them all in because I don't know for sure like who's who. And that's like part of the benefit of having this like anonymous like online bullying account. Like it's really like the saddest thing. And the fact that anyone thinks that it's like okay is insane to me. But they like there was some like woman that they some woman in poker who I don't even know. But they were like, I guess somewhat beefing with her on Twitter for whatever reason. And they went and like, I don't know how, but they found some pictures of her on like an escort service and then posted them like at her, you know, like tweeting them like to everyone, like, hey, like, look at this woman. I'm sure they didn't use a word like that. They probably called her a bitch or whatever. And like, here are like these pictures of her, like, you know, we knew that she was doing this. It's like, this is really fucked. Like you're just invading someone's personal life. And yeah, it's on a public site, but like, why, like, how hateful are you to go and expose this person's private life like this? What has she done that is like really deserving of it? And I think it's just really like disgusting. And you know, there's like, that's just, that was honestly the moment that I was just like, you know, I'm not going to keep my mouth shut anymore.
Interesting. Yeah. I haven't heard about that.
Yeah. I mean, like whatever, like I'm over it for the most part. Like I said, I don't really care like what they have to say to me. It's laughable because, you know, if they're not willing to just say it in person, and not only that, like they're not even willing to say it on their own accounts, which is like the most embarrassing thing. It's like, it's just Twitter. Just like say what you're going to say. But like, I'll see like Barry in line at Starbucks or like walk past him coming in and out of the door. It's like, he doesn't say anything to me. It's like, just walks past me. It's like, okay. Like I'm happy to talk with you anytime and maybe like find out why you have this animosity toward me. But it's just like, nah, I'd rather just like talk shit occasionally and not, you know, ever address it in a, like a real man to man sense.
Maybe you'll catch them outside the Rio and break their fucking nose one time too.
No, it's like, I'm really not upset. It's not like a, you know, it's not something I'm not looking to fight about it. Like I'm 32 years old. Like I'm not even looking to schedule a cage match. You know, it's not sport. It's just like, hey, I just like, I would like to know why you think this. I think I'm a pretty reasonable person, but I'm biased. I understand. But let's, you know, let's figure things out. And that's kind of how I feel like about, you know, everyone. Like I, you know, there are some people that you're just not going to get along with. Right. And no matter how good of a person you are, there are going to be people that think you're an asshole. And you're just not going to be able to please everyone. You're not going to be able to get everyone to like you. And being like in this very dim limelight in like the poker community has taught me that in spades. But I feel like for people that are actually in the community with you, you kind of almost owe it to one another to like just say something, you know? It's like, yeah, if someone like watched me versus you and thinks I'm a, you know, whatever, like doesn't like me, okay, that's fine. You know, you watched a show on the internet and you don't like me, that's okay. I felt that way about people I've seen on the internet too. But when you're actually like with these people and you play with them on, you know, somewhat regular basis, it's like, hey, you know, this is an issue that I have. I'm always happy to talk about it. And you might be right. I'm not, you know, I'm not the best person. I try to be my best person, but I know that I can occasionally rub people the wrong way. And that's, you know, that's something that I would love to talk about, but it seems that people aren't as interested in that.
Well, maybe you guys will get to have that conversation at some point in time, I guess.
Hopefully. I would love to talk. I mean, I think I'm less interested in talking to Burbick because it's like, I don't know. I haven't seen him in real life in like, I don't know, many years. Unless maybe I have, and I just don't really know what he looks like. But, you know, he seems like kind of just like always angry or always upset about something. But like, you know, Barry and Jake, like I see them a fair amount. Like I would like to talk to both of them, honestly. So hopefully, I mean, I'm going to go to Florida in 10 days or for 10 days in August for the tournaments at Hard Rock. So hopefully we can actually talk.
Well, guys, we can take a couple of questions from the chat. We're going to wrap things up here.
Yeah, please. It's 2 hours. Shit.
That's how the podcasts go sometimes, Dan. They go some length once in a while.
Yeah. See, I can ramble. I just don't know. Like it's really hard to digest like a 2 hour podcast. I think you have to have like two seconds.
Some people do, some people don't. I mean, that's kind of, it's kind of, I mean, I do it for myself, man. What's up?
I appreciate anyone that, you know, has listened for the whole time. I think that's a lot of attention span to give the two of us. And I respect that. I appreciate it.
Let's see some more. Ask. No, I'm not going to ask that. What the hell kind of fucking weird question is that? Honestly. Tell the story about your right to dance again.
I'm not going to do that. But it's, I mean, I would, but it's just like, it's so long ago. But the long and short of it is I was in the O'Shea's bar, like the newer version in the Link, like a couple of years ago.
Shout out to O'Shea's. Okay.
Yeah. And I think it was on St. Patty's Day, 'cause that's the only time I ever go there. And I was there with some Ultimate Poker people, like some of the, you know, like, our bosses or whatever. And also like D Moon Girl, Jay Carver was there, his boyfriend Vincent, and USC Fildo was there. And we were just like, we were having a good time and dancing in the like area of the like, of that like little like hangout or bar that you could dance in.
Right.
And since we were having so much fun, a crowd, like a circle formed around us. And like, we were like in the circle dancing. And the bouncers were really annoyed that this was happening and like blocking people's paths. And they're like, hey, like, stop this. Like, get out of here. It's like, we're just dancing. Like, tell them to stop circling up. Like, I don't understand what you want. Like, we're not doing anything wrong. And they kind of kept coming back and like yelling at us to like break it up. It's like, everyone else is standing around. We're literally just standing in one place and dancing. And this was an issue for them. So eventually they like, you know, they came back and like threatened to kick us out. I was like, hey buddy, like you have to do what you have to do. It's like, I'm not going to stop dancing. So we ended up like kicking out like Phil. I don't know. Like, I remember there were like some kind of funny specifics in what like I said to these guys. 'Cause it's just like such a ridiculous thing. It was very like footloose. Like, you're not allowed to dance here. But you know, I had some words for the guys because I thought that they were being so ridiculous, and we were all kicked out of O'Shea's for dancing, which is just kind of insane recounting it. But you know, that we had a good time. That was like Ultimate Poker. That was a great time. There was a lot of great people that worked there. Sad it didn't work out, but like developing a, well, Jay Carver and I were close before and after, but like D Moon, like I didn't know her really at all before. It's like, oh, she plays poker, but I don't know her. But like our friendship has been like a huge like side benefit to being signed by Ultimate Poker.
Hmm. I'm surprised O'Shea's kicked you out, man. They're very it's like a very fun place and very.
We were really putting on a show. I mean, that's clear. We had to be putting on quite a show to be booted.
All right, last question here. What did you do? Where's that one that he's asked? D. Sanchez says, best advice he could give to someone playing 2-5 now that wants to move up to high stakes live cash.
Best advice I can give someone who wants to move up to high stakes live cash. I mean, I don't play high stakes, so I don't know if I'm your guy. I do play like 5-10, 10.25, occasionally bigger. it's hard, like. Honestly, one of the best things that I've looked at in a while was going through the Upswing Poker Lab. And, you know, for transparency's sake, they sponsored the first two episodes of our podcast, but this has nothing to do with that. I think it's really good and like fundamentally important to kind of like develop a basis for how to play against good players. So it definitely helped.
I just snapped this, by the way. I forgot to put this on Snapchat. Dan, go ahead.
So that definitely helped me to kind of like solidify my fundamental game for when I'm playing with good players. And as you move up in stakes, there's going to be more of those good players. And then outside of that, like, don't worry about what good players think of your plays when you're playing against the amateurs, because you need to be doing everything you can to be exploitive and not GTO, in my opinion. And just, you know, like doing whatever it takes to win as much money from possible as you can from them. And if like the, even if every like pro at the table knows what you have, it doesn't matter. They're not in the hand. You just do what you can to get all of the money. So I think that's most of poker is, you know, especially like in the live venue, is just being at a table where there's a couple of like really good players for the game and maximizing your profit from them while holding your head up or, you know, staying above water against the other pros.
I like that advice. That's pretty good advice. Upswing Poker Lab.
Yeah, man, it was really good, and you know, props to them. I pretty much, the only thing I ever look at in terms of like poker training is the Upswing Lab and Run It Once. I think Run It Once is great. They have, you know, a million things. You just have to sort through them and see what works for you.
Right. It's all about how much you put into it, it's how much you get back from it.
Yeah.
The more you put into studying, the more you could potentially get back from it. So I think that's going to be it, guys. If you want to follow Dan, Dan, you on Twitter, you on Snapchat, you got a lot of shit, man. What are you on? You on Twitter, yeah, right? Twitter.
I'm on all of it, and it's all Dan O'Brien Poker. It's easy enough.
Twitter, Dan O'Brien Poker, Snapchat.
Yeah, Dan O'Brien Poker on Snapchat and Instagram and Facebook.com/Dan O'Brien Poker. But like Facebook is so useless to me these days.
Yeah. I feel the same about it.
Everything else is great. I don't snap too much, but you know, when I do, I think it's worthwhile. I got some good EDC shit. Mostly it's just like my dogs, but occasionally it's something entertaining. You never know. Sometimes I might even like hit the story like by accident, and then you'll get a dick pic on there. So,
huh? Poker. I ain't got one of those yet, man.
my initial name on, all right. So my actual initial name on Snapchat, because when I first got it, it was like, why does everyone like this? It's clearly just for sending naked pictures. Like, what else would you use this for? Oh, so boy. My first name on there was No Dicks Please. And then I told my roommate, I was like, hey, you're going to love my Snapchat name. Guess what it is? And he goes, Dick Pic Dan. I was like, no, but it is now. And then I changed my name to Dick Pic Dan for a while. And even though, you know, I rarely lived up to it, I just thought it was a good name. And then when I decided that it was actually something that could be useful in terms of like, then I got a new account, Dan O'Brien Poker. That's a lot more, you know, PC. But I thought I just couldn't advertise Dick Pic Dan as a Snapchat name. It just didn't seem right.
Well, Dick Pic Dan, appreciate you joining us on the podcast today. You guys can also find his podcast, Fighting Chance, on iTunes as well, too. Search Fighting Chance. And how many more episodes of that can we expect? You said you got one coming out today, and then anything after that?
This episode comes out today, and then there's going to be two more. So okay. 2 weeks of podcasts, check those out, and you know they'll just survive forever. So check out whatever you want, subscribe, and hopefully if we get a bunch of people listening, maybe we can make some more.
Well, cool. Dan, appreciate you coming on the podcast. Guys in the chat, very much thank you for all the questions, all the comments. If you missed the podcast, you can find it on iTunes, or you can watch it back on my YouTube channel. And that's it, man. That's it. I'll be back. I might stream some this weekend on Twitch. I'm not sure. I'll probably be back Monday with a podcast with Sorel Mizzy, which...
Oh, nice.
We tried scheduling this before, and you know, there's a lot of controversy around Sorel. So,
yeah, there is. I like Sorel. I think he has a good heart. We've talked a lot. But yeah, you know, everyone kind of has to be held accountable for what they've done. And I think he recognizes that and hopefully, you know, improves himself by the day, just like we're all trying to. Well, hey, yo, let me know when... let me know when you come back to Vegas. We didn't even get to hang out this summer. I invited you to come hang out with me at EDC, and I didn't even see you there.
Yeah, I went there. I went there only for a couple. I went there with a friend.
Okay. But yeah, I might be in LA for a bit. I don't know. In a few weeks, so I'll let you know.
Yeah, let me know. I might go to LA. I might stay here for a bit and try to win.
Oh yeah,
that's
right. Chicago. Yeah, I'll get there eventually too. Chicago, Joey. Forgot about that.
Yeah. All right, guys in the chat, much love. Appreciate all the comments. Appreciate all the questions. I'm out of here. Peace. I'll see you, Dan.
Later.